Hi, everybody. My name is Lenore von Stein, and this is another episode of The Facts. And The Facts we do is a music show that also has episodes of discussion. And today we're talking to Michael Parenti, political scientist, analyst, author. He wrote a book called Democracy for Now that I use as a textbook in some classes I teach in, and my students really like this book, and I really like this book.
Democracy for the Few.
Yeah, Democracy for the Few. Michael, I'm wondering if you, in line of the idea of democracy, what's democracy supposed to achieve? I don't know if that's a silly question. Now, what is it supposed to achieve? What are the purposes of democracy? The idea.
Well, democracy is an invention by the people of history to defend themselves against the abuses of wealth. They're a way of people getting up and saying, you've got all these powers, you've got all these prerogatives, you've got all the decision making, you've got all the police force mobilized in this particular society to serve your interests. We will have to get ourselves together and we will have to find another mode of decision making other than the dictatorial or the oligarchic. In ancient Greece, the Hoplites, who were the small farmers, they demanded an assembly, and they demanded a one man one vote in the assembly. They said if each of us can be they were infantry when they went into the army. They had enough money being small farmers and artisans. They had enough money to buy their own sword and shield and all that and form this infantry. And the view was if we're good enough to fight these wars, we want to say in whether we should have a war or not have a war and whose interests are being served by this war. And there were some Greek aristocratic leaders at the time, like Cleisthenes, and later on a young nephew of Cleisthenes from aristocratic families, but who were themselves Democrats. They wanted an expansion of power and decision-making to democracy. The most famous one being Pericles, the most famous democratic leader in ancient Greece. But all through history, there were republics in India. There were republics in Renaissance Italy, where assemblies were formed, and whether they were really, one person, one vote, I wouldn't put my life on that. But there was this very strong struggle for the common people having a say, and that's what democracy is about. The Putney debates, the levelers, the diggers, various people in England. This was back in the late 16th, early 17th centuries. So for centuries, people have fought democracy. Demos means rule of the people, uh-huh. By the people and for themselves. It's a really serious, it's about the only weapon we have to defend ourselves against the powers of money and force. One of the first things, Engels pointed this out, one of the first things that class, the top class that accumulates a surplus of property and wealth, one of the first things they do is they begin to hire the very poor. And being very poor, they're willing to serve anybody and do the dirty work of those above them if they could get food to eat. And bands of armed retainers is what Engels called it. that the people who controlled property would have these bands of armed retainers, and that was the beginning of the state. Well, within that state, what you had were people saying the state should not be serving the rich and the powerful. This state should be serving all the people who do the work, the people who make things happen and life happen.
So
that's the historical roots of democracy. It's not just a textbook little fanciful idea we have in school now. It's rooted very much in the history of class struggle, in the history of the fight between the super rich and the rest of us. And it's still, that's still the fight today. The trouble with today is it's devolved into a plutocracy. And plutocracy, as opposed to democracy, the demos doesn't rule, the plutocrats rule. Plutocrats are rich. Plutocracy means ruled by the moneyed. And that's what we have today. When you have to spend $7.5 billion in 2012 on all the elections we had then, including about more than $3 billion spent just on Romney and Obama in the presidential election, you're not talking democracy anymore. You're talking about plutocracy.
It seems like...
And I was... Well, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
People are, I mean, this word democracy just gets, you know, thrown around, and people are so far removed from what it actually, or it seemed to be, maybe not so far, but removed from what it actually is. For instance, the cost of these elections, or we just had an election here in New Jersey. The governor of New Jersey decided to have a special election and spend $25 million on this special election, which he could have had during the regular election time and not spent $25 million. And because don't we need the $25 million for other things? The issue that I wanted to address is the difference in how far away people are, or the difference between what they conceive of as democracy and what we have as a democracy, and how we bridge that gap. I hope I'm...
Yeah, well, that's a hard thing. When I was first studying politics some 60 years ago, looking at it as an undergraduate, I remember that candidates used to be very shy about letting it be known how much money they had and how much money they were spending. They would use fronts, they would use committees to take the money and spend it in the name of some committee rather than in the name of the candidate. And there were limitations on how much they could spend. And it would have been a very, uncomfortable thing to someone in charge. Oh, you bought that election, you spent so much, it is this. Today, it's just the opposite. Today, you had George W. Bush win the Republican nomination. He simply got up and said, I got the money. He had all the big backers backed George W. And that's called the money primary sometimes. So you have a primary where you go in and you vote, let's say the Republican primary or the Democratic primary. You have several candidates running in each. You think it's just a vote, but before that, there's the money primary where these candidates will even get up and talk about their war chest. And so I say to you, are you sure you want to run against me? Because look at my war chest. I got $45 million to win that seat in Congress. And what do you have? You got peanuts. You're finished. And sometimes you can knock them out and beat them just with this money primary. The money primary, there's no voting. You just get up and you announce how much you got and you show it. So you're already prefiguring the outcome of the election to some degree, the selection of the final candidates through this money primary. The second primary is the media primary, and that's very important. The media looks and they make declarations. They say, oh, Bill Clinton is the forerunner here. he's the one. Yeah, David Rockefeller picked him too and said he should run. And suddenly the media is treating him as a forerunner, a serious candidate, you see.
Yes, yes.
Whereas Jill Stein running on Green Party ticket, she's not a serious candidate. She only has, you know, a few $100,000 to carry out her campaign. She doesn't fly in a private jet all over the place. She goes on a bus or in a car from one speaking place to another with smaller crowds, obviously, gets no media coverage. She's lost the media primary. If you lose, out and out lose the media primary, you're knocked out of the election to come. So you have all these things happening, and this really removes us further and further away from democracy. And yet people are fed a line about the messianic wonders of America. I have people come up to me, and Lenore, you've had that happen to you, some coming up and say, this is the best country in the world. This is the,
yes,
the greatest country in the world, and don't you, and if you don't like it, you can go. And you have to say, I don't dislike my country. This is my home as much as it's yours. I'd like to see things that are abusing it and betraying it. I'd like to see those things changed and improved. And that's a hard one to get these people to understand. And that messianic image of America, that we're special, we're God's gift to humanity. We're so marvelous. And you have to teach your students about the horrors, the genocidal horrors of purging the North American continent of upwards of, what was it, 7-8 million people who lived here, called Indians. They weren't in India at all, they were in North America, but then the 300 years of slavery, followed by another 100 years of lynch mob, Jim Crow segregation. We have things. We're not God's gift to humanity. We're no greater, no more beautiful, no more fair and square and peace loving than any other people. We have things in our history, and if you look at the history of many countries, most countries, in fact, they have fascinating histories. Histories about ethnic conflicts and strong personalities, struggles by the mass peoples, fighting back, all this sort of thing happening. So we're no better and we're no worse than a lot of other countries. In some ways we're worse because we have this enormous power and this enormous base here. They don't have enough money for job programs. They don't have enough money to fix the infrastructure of our society. But they got enough money, over $1 trillion every year spent on military weaponry, military wars, and bases all over the world. And that's to keep that world safe for the Fortune 500, for that 1% up at the top. And that's why our democracy is so wanting and faulty, because the resources and concerns of democracy are not taken into hand. What's being served here is the interests of those who try to expropriate the land, the labor, the natural resources, and the markets of every other place in the world, and gather it all unto themselves and to other plutocrats in some of these other countries too, who cooperate completely with them.
Do you have notions about how this is broken through, this idea of let me put it another way. Sometimes when I'm speaking to people about this, they seem to be positively hurt by the idea that the powers that be aren't doing for them, you know, the good thing. That it's like daddy loves me and they're taking care of me, and it, you know, if they say it, it's the thing we have to do. Sometimes I think it's this kind of the absence of detail that they have to pull on about what is actually going on. But there's also this included in that is or ancillary to that is this deep-seated emotional need to believe that what you're told is okie dokie. And
I had a student tell me he had faith in the president. I said, what? Faith? What are we doing, religion or politics here? He said, well, I trust the president. I said, well, democracy isn't about trust, it's about distrust. Democracy is about transparency, accountability, debate, exposure, dialogue, debate again. and you don't blindly trust these leaders. That's why we've got elections. That's why we've got criticisms. That's why we've got opposition parties, supposedly, that they should really get at the fundamentals. Yeah, but you see, along with the messianic theme of, you know, we're the greatest, we're wonderful, we're delivering to humankind. We fight. Excuse me. We fight humanitarian wars. We have wars, it's true, but they're humanitarian. And that's everything we do is virtuous. Sometimes the people don't go along with the leaders. When the Kuwait war George Herbert Walker Bush, the old man, not W, yes, but yes, his yes. father, when he was president, they couldn't get support. Like Obama today can't get support from the public to get into a full-scale war in Syria. Mm-hmm. The people do not want to go and fight the war. So they're not always swept up by this messianic talk about how wonderful we are, how we got to save the world, how we got to help all these poor little people who somehow can't get it together. They don't know how to take care of themselves. We have to come in and take care of them. We have to go to countries like Egypt and Persia, countries that have civilizations that are 6,000 or 7,000 years older than our, 3,000 or 4,000 years older than us. And we have to teach them how to govern themselves. And a lot of people don't fall for it. And when Bill Clinton started bombing Belgrade and he hit the Danube, the bridges on the Danube, and killed all these people in buses and all that, the support for the war in Yugoslavia dropped by 20 points. The minute that happened, he bombed all the Yugoslav media outlets, so no more of those pictures would get out.
Wow.
And what they turned to then is they put aside the messianic, and they talk about the realpolitik, the threat, the demon out there. There's a demon out there, and we got to go. And once you frighten people enough, they will be willing to sacrifice their taxes, their purses, their everything. They don't want to see their homes, their children, themselves destroyed by some awful evil. Yesterday it was the terrorists or the communists, and people used to have I used to have arguments with people and say we got to knock them out first strike, drop nuclear bombs. They would have dropped nuclear bombs on Russia. I mean, you know what that would have done to the whole world? I mean, the whole atmosphere and everything else, the levels of radiation would be unbelievable. But that was it. It was always, there was a communist, going to get your mama, everything. And now it's the terrorists. They decided, oh, there are these terrorists, and they are just out to kill all of us because they are jealous about how successful and prosperous and happy we are. Yeah, some success and some happiness. So that you play on the fear of people. And that Kuwait thing I was telling you about, George Herbert Walker Bush, mm-hmm. when he said, but if Saddam Hussein has nuclear weapons, they put out a poll. He didn't say weapons of mass destruction. That term hadn't come in vogue yet. He said, if Saddam Hussein has nuclear weapons, and he looks like he's prepared to use them, would you want us then to move in and stop him? Well, of course, you know, I mean, if you say, so-and-so's got a knife and he's going to cut your throat, would you want to stop him? But you haven't really demonstrated that he has a knife, that he wants to use it against you or anything like that. But they started putting up this thing about, not about justice for the Kuwaitis, not about justice for the Iraqis with a ruler like Saddam Hussein, overlooking the fact that it was the CIA that put Saddam Hussein in power in Iraq. In the hope that he would hand over all the oil back to the British and American petroleum companies and do all these other things that fit in as a satellite country would do. And instead, he kept the oil for Iraq. He kept all that stuff for himself. and he committed economic nationalism. He started working and building Iraq for itself, and then that's when they started with this other fear appeal, which is this guy is worse than Hitler. This guy's going to. Before that, when he was playing along with the CIA, they loved him. He was Washington's poster boy. There were pictures taken of Rumsfeld, Secretary of Defense, and Saddam Hussein, like they were just smiling there, holding each other. And once he stepped out of line on the oil quotas, he wanted a bigger chunk of the oil market to sell into it. Once he stepped out of line on welcoming private investments from the West, and he didn't want them, he wanted to develop. And you know, Iraq had one of the best standards of living in the Middle East. It had. Today it's way down in the world. It's one of the lowest, poorest, strife-ridden countries in the world after all the fighting and the war and the invasion. Well, that's when the American people started switching over and getting behind Bush. When he started hitting them with the thing that this guy's out to get you, this guy's going to kill us if we don't get him first. And people would say that. Look, it's either him or me, and we got to go after him and teach him a lesson, you know. And they got to respect us. We got to keep our reputation and our word and our strength and all that stuff. And if they think we're weak and unreliable, they'll come in and get us. Who are all these people that are out to just kill America? What? They don't want to kill Norway. They don't want to kill Finland or Denmark. But it's America. America is besieged by all these wicked, dark demons that are all around us somewhere.
Just like,
and that's what gets people to cough up all this money. The empire feeds off the republic. This empire has this immense war machine, a global war machine, and meanwhile, the republic is falling apart. These bridges are falling apart right out here in the Bay Area, for God's sake. Some of our roads, our potholes, our schools, they're closing our libraries, they're closing our schools. They can't afford them anymore. And where's all that money going? You know where it's going. It's going into this military, global military apparatus.
How did Rome fall?
What?
I know this might be outside your kin, but how did Rome fall? Why did Rome fall?
Why did Rome fall?
Yeah.
You know, I wrote a book about Rome called The Assassination of Julius Caesar. You go read the book and you'll get the answer right there. But Rome reached the point where the individual plundering and the decadence and the corruption was such that they could mobilize people to protect them against the intrusions that came from the north. I mean, people came down, a lot of the people from Central Europe, it was freezing up there, don't forget, freezing. Once they got down, it happened with a number of conquerors. Once they got into Italy, I mean, the climate in Italy is lovely compared to, say, you know, parts of northern Germany. And so you had those kinds of invasions. Rome was sacked a number of times. It was a process that went on for years. And
where are the most inclusive? We're about 4 minutes from the end of this program. Where are the most inclusive democracies? Or I'm not going to call them democracies. The most progressive countries right now, who are they and how do they get that way?
Well, they're mostly Northern Europe. They got that way by staying out of the war. Norway stood out of the war. They got invaded by the Germans, but they didn't get any prolonged fighting. Sweden stayed out of the war. Switzerland, by the war, I mean World War II. Uh-huh. Switzerland stayed out of the war. Finland had a Finno-Russian War, the Russo-Finnish War, I think it's called. And that was a very limited. The Russians just wanted that lower peninsula to take it over because they knew if the Germans got in there, they'd be able to destroy Leningrad. And once they took that over, that war was over, that war stopped. And the Finns have been able, and in addition to that, after World War II, you had the Red Army troops, the Soviet troops, all along the Elbe. You had all of Eastern Europe, now communist. You had a communist party in Italy, very big one, a very big communist party in France. And what happened there was the ruling class, and it happened in America too, about the same time after World War II. It was called the Great Compromise. It was the ruling owning class saying, okay, we're not going to seek to destroy you. We'll accept labor unions. Okay, we'll accept the 8-hour day. Okay, you can have vacations and pensions and this and that and the other thing. And they said, in other words, they were buying off their own working classes. They're saying, listen, you don't have to go communist. You don't have to become that, what's going on there. Because in Eastern Europe, for whatever else they were, police states, they were not, you know, multi-party systems. I mean, there may have been a few other parties besides the Communist Party. In a lot of these states, there were. But they were small, little token. Like we have little third parties that can't get anywhere. But they had all of this sort of thing. They also had in Eastern Europe they had guaranteed right to a job, affordable state-owned apartments to rent. I mean, there was often a long waiting list, but people did live better than they had lived during the war or before the war. The working class got free medical care, and on and on like this. So these concessions started being made in Western Europe, and this was called social democracy, where it's not just democracy of the political system, but it's democracy of the economic system, where you still have big corporations, you still have big millionaires and all that, but they have to get a progressive income tax, they had to face that, and that happened in the U.S. too, and little by little that was all rolled back. Today the corporations pay less taxes than I do, or you do, mm-hmm. and so that answers who are the countries that did okay.
Yeah. So I think we're 20 seconds away from the end of this episode. What we're going to do, ladies and gentlemen, is we're going to tape another episode. So we're going to continue this discussion. You'll see it a week later. For right now, Michael, I'd like to say goodnight and thank you very much for joining us on this episode, and I'm going to see you in about 10 minutes, okay? So this is The Facts. Bye.
All right. Bye-bye.